As we continue our survey of the different fields in ecology, we're now going to expand out to the largest possible scale, that is of ecosystem ecology, where now we're going to focus on the physical environment and its effects on communities. First, let's define an ecosystem as a regionally defined assemblage of species and its associated physical and chemical processes. Ecosystem ecology, as other fields of ecology, are interested in the distribution and abundance of species. But besides just looking at biotic factors, things that have to do with living things, as we did in population ecology and community ecology, we now consider what are called abiotic factors, or non-living factors. And these are two types, physical and chemical. And first, we'll look at physical factors. The most important thing about life on Earth is that our energy that we all rely on in terms of carbohydrates that we get from plants ultimately comes from the sun. The sun is 93 million miles away, and only a small fraction of its energy reaches the Earth's atmosphere. A fair amount of that is reflected immediately back into space from the upper atmosphere. A large proportion is absorbed by the atmosphere, and the rest comes down and helps to drive the water cycle, which will be rainfall, and a small amount is captured as photosynthesis. So rainfall is an important consequence of the heat that arrives on the Earth from the sun. And photosynthesis, of course, is ultimately what feeds us, providing carbohydrates for all living things. The sun's rays are strongest at the equator, and with direct sunshine, you get more energy to evaporate water from the oceans that then rise. As they rise and reach the cooler layers of the atmosphere, they condense to form clouds and we get rain. This updraft at the equator sets up a series of trade winds that predominate going away and have certain characteristics. As they move away from the equator, these winds are now drying out because most of the rainfall has been lost. And so you have dry descending air. Consequently, you have this band around the equator of humid rainforests surrounded on either side by deserts. And then eventually the currents come back up again and we have more moisture coming up in the air. We have more forests. That's repeated again as drier deserts at the poles. So you have these typical bands of rainfall at different distances away from the equator. Now, where you have more precipitation and you have nice warm temperatures, that's the place we'd all like to be at this time of year in Minnesota. We'd rather be down in the equator in a tropical evergreen forest. If there's not as much rainfall, but it's still warm, then in these hotter climates, you get dry forest, thorn forest, or even hot desert. Further north, the temperature is not as warm, the rainfall is not quite as high, and so we have certain kinds of forests, savannas. Further north still, you get boreal forest. Finally, in the far north, the only thing that can grow up there is called tundra, and we'll look at tundra in some detail later. The bottom line of this graph is that down here at the bottom right, where you have the combination of rainfall and high temperature, that's where you have the most plant biomass being produced. The further away from these two ideals, the drier, it's desert, or the cold, it's tundra, and you don't get nearly as much biomass. So if we look at the distribution of net primary productivity, which is abbreviated as NPP, that's the quantity of organic matter produced by photosynthesis. That's simply just plant biomass. And this is most abundant at the equator, and as you move north, you're less and less. And also when you go into the deserts like in the Sahara or the Antarctica, which is another desert, there's very little biomass. So, simple. Rainfall and temperature are determined by latitude, and in turn, rainfall and temperature determine how rapidly and how abundantly the plants can grow. So geography is destiny.